Hey everybody, welcome back to another episode of Gavinsky's Tutorials. Today I'm going to do a walkthrough, demo and review of Wavebox by Audiothing. So this has been out for desktop for a good few years now, but it just came out for iPad and iPhone. And this is a dual waveshaping effect plugin. So it works standalone or as a plugin, in this case on iPad. I'm using it here inside the host app AUM. As an AUV3. And if you are buying this, by the way, for desktop or other plugins by Audiothing or by many other different developers, if you're a fan of my channel and you'd like to support me, it'd be great if you use the plugin boutique link that you'll find in the pinned comment of this video. It's a great way to help my channel at no extra cost to you. Thanks, guys. So I'll do a walkthrough of all the controls. Let's just have a little listen first. So most of the presets use modulation. So we got two LFOs and an envelope follower built in. You could always use external modulation sources if you want as well. And so this allows you to use symmetrical or asymmetrical distortion. And if you don't know what those are, that's all stuff I'll explain later in the video. I love distortion plugins. This seems like a really good one. Great sound, and it's very versatile. Let's go over here. So here I just got Dagger by Beep Street. Just doing a little one note. Very simple input. And let's switch to the init preset and go from there. So first, just very quick overview of the UI. So here we've got a visualizer. Here you've got this shaping section. And so here we've got a choice of two different functions that we can choose, and you can have just one of them if you want. You know, you can turn them off, right? And that can be a good thing to do when you're first learning it, to kind of get an idea of what different things sound like. You've got two LFOs and an envelope follower. Unfortunately, that is fixed architecture. So for example, I wish you could tap here and, you know, decide whether it's an LFO or an envelope follower. I would definitely like to be able to have three envelope followers, let's say, instead of being stuck with this. But you can always use external ones. Then you got a filter section here. Tap here, by the way, to select your filter type. And tap here to select your LFO type. Tap here to select LFO destinations. And then here you got a master section with some controls related to the input and output. You got a randomizer here, by the way, and Audiothing always have this nice little lock function where you can lock things if you don't want them to be randomized when you hit the randomize button. So that's really nice. Just tap again and unlock those, and then tap this, and that's now back to normal where everything can be randomized. So let's just jump back to this init preset. So you really need to understand symmetrical and asymmetrical distortion. So in this app, when this button is turned off, it's using symmetrical distortion. So symmetrical distortion can create odd harmonics mainly. And then if you turn it on, now it can do asymmetrical distortion, and that can also create even harmonics. Now, this bias slider is very important, but if you're starting with the init slider, or sorry, with the init preset, and you're trying to change that, it won't do anything, because here in the init patch, these are set up as the same function and their curve value is identical. You know, they're both set to 50%. Because what the bias slider will do is it will kind of morph between these or mix between them depending on whether you're in symmetrical or asymmetrical mode. So let's just change things up so you can understand how the bias slider works. So let's just first take, let's make this say a linear function. So here all we're doing basically is drawing a shape, just choosing a shape. So at the moment, note this is off, right? A white is on. So it's off, so it's symmetrical. And so here in the symmetrical mode, each function can shape the entire input signal. So you can see here when I change this curve knob, we're getting changes happening in the whole signal. But if I change this, if I turn this on and we're now in asymmetrical mode, see what happens when I change, Just put bias back at 50. So see here when I change the curve amount, you see it's only changing up here in the upper part of the visualizer. So it's only changing in the positive section above this horizontal line. And if I had something here and I am changing this, now it's changing in the negative section, right? So in the asymmetrical mode, it's like that, right? Here we'll be changing how it behaves above this line. Here with the second function, we're changing how it behaves below this line. So you can get a lot of different sounds just by playing around with these. I'm playing around with the bias amount and stuff. Now the ceiling, that's just setting the dynamic range. So if we bring that all the way down, you see this just becomes totally flat. So if you're experimenting, it's probably better to keep that up, at least keep it pretty high up. So let's just look at a couple of different presets. So let's turn the modulation off. And you see, just by playing around with the curve amount and the bias knob, see that because that bias was down here, it wasn't doing much. So the bias knob, let's talk about that a bit more. So when you're in the symmetrical mode with this button off, this bias is just working as a kind of mix control. So when it's all the way down here, it's just function 2 being applied. When it's all the way up here, it's just function 1. And here we got a 50-50 mix. If I turn this on, now we're basically changing the transition point from one of the functions to the other. And the main thing is we're just getting really a very different quality of sound. And so then, of course, once we start modulating these things, well, you know, it can get pretty crazy. So let's say, modulate curve 1 and then turn this on. And there we go. And so the LFO, you can have it synced or unsynced. Dial in the amount. So depending what direction you want it to go, dial in a negative amount or a positive amount. Change the phase by dragging up and down here. And so you could have two LFOs set to the same destination as well if you wanted. Right. Now for the envelope follower, let's switch over to one of the other examples. So here I've just got Circa, and I recorded Fundamental 2 into this, just a few different loops. And here we have this. So let's just go to the init patch again. And let's assign the envelope follower to something. So let's change. Let's actually change from the init patch to something else. Get something that this sounds good on. Let's see. Okay, let's take this one. So let me turn this LFO off first. So just now this LFO was modulating curve 2. So let's see what happens when we instead use the envelope follower to modulate curve 2. So you've got to remember to turn these on. So again, look, we have our amount. So you see curve 2 is turned all the way down. So if you want to modulate that with the envelope follower, you're going to want to make sure that you're dialing in a positive amount, right? If instead the curve knob was set like this, you'd want to dial in a negative amount. And then adjust attack and release values to taste. So we just change the destinations here. And again, you know, pay attention to the position of the slider or the knob you're modulating, and what would be the appropriate direction for the envelope follower amount. That's super important. The filter's not even on. Yeah, I was wondering what was going on there. So again, filter section. You got these various types you can choose from. And then here, you've got your master. Oh, those are still locked. Okay, hang on. So in the master section, it's got a hard clipper and limiter built in, but the output knob comes after that. So if you're putting very loud input into the app, you know, and then you're kind of testing out the factory presets, I would recommend don't put that input up too high, or, you know, you might go into the red. And another solution is put a limiter after this. Just use another limiter app after it. I'm using Tone Booster's Barricade after this, just so I don't have to worry too much about my input levels. And you got oversampling here. Mainly just been keeping it off or low. I haven't really noticed any aliasing. And then control your input mix and output amounts. So let's just jump back to this example. I'll go through some presets and also just make a few final comments about what I like and what I think could be improved. So great sound, and honestly, you know, with all these different shapes and with curve amounts and controlling the bias and the ceiling and so on, it's very versatile. Sound is top notch, as I would expect from Audiothing. And the filters and everything sound great. UI is not as nice as some of their more recent plugins. And I think it could be a bit more obvious, you know, when it's symmetrical, when it's asymmetrical. But the main thing I'd really like to see improved would be possibilities for more destinations here. So you could do cross modulation, but even more importantly, having the ability to have three envelope followers if you want, instead of being stuck with this fixed architecture of two LFOs and just one envelope follower. But as I said earlier, you can use external LFOs and envelope followers. I often tend to use FAC Envolver or Envolver on iOS as an envelope follower plugin. Or there's GSDSP's MMM app as well that's free. Oh, another little criticism, just I really don't like the arrows for the preset browsers in these Audiothing apps. It's a bit tricky to hit, you know, forward or backwards. It's absolutely no problem whatsoever with a mouse, but with the finger it can be a bit annoying. It won't be nice to turn the sync off and adjust it manually. See, that's the kind of thing it would be really nice to put the other LFO on and modulate that rate knob. Again, just use external LFO. So I hope you found this video useful, everybody. If you did, please smash the like, etc. And do remember, if you're a fan of the channel, there are loads of different ways you can support me in the pinned comment. And that support is really crucial for small channels like this, because there's absolutely almost no significant ad revenue whatsoever from YouTube. So support from developers and viewers is really the only possible way that channels like mine can survive and thrive. Thank you to those people who are supporting me. Really appreciate it. And I'll see you all in the next video. Take it easy. Cheers.